This is Kim speaking, and good morning to all of you. Thank you for carving out time in your schedule to be here with us today. My name is Kim Woolridge. I'm Deputy Executive Director with the Michigan Department of Civil Rights, and I'm honored to welcome you all to the 2023 Civil Rights Summit, hosted by the Michigan Department of Civil Rights and the Michigan Civil Rights Commission. Before we get started, I have a few housekeeping reminders for everyone. We currently are in the main room. We also have two other rooms next to the main room. Those rooms are to my right. The bathrooms are outside of this room on this floor to my left. All sessions today will have an ASL interpreter and live captioning in each room. Additionally, our sessions will be recorded today for later viewing. If you have any questions or need assistance with anything, please visit our registration table to speak with an MDCR staff person, which is right outside of the main doors. Or visit the WHOVA platform on your mobile device or laptop. And now, without further preamble, it is my pleasure to introduce Reverend Matthew Cockrum, a chaplain with Corewell Health, to officially welcome us to our 2023 summit focused on the impact of discrimination on health.
Good morning and welcome. It's an honor and a privilege to be here with you today and to start our time together with a time of grounding and continuing to arrive, and most importantly, arriving in our bodies. For this work takes place with and through our bodies, and we experience the resilience and the resistance through our work with our minds and our bodies. The theme of today's gathering, like trees, problems have roots, invites us to root ourselves first. And so I invite you to take a moment and just notice your body. Maybe your heartbeat, the pace of your breath. You can either keep your eyes open or soften your gaze, or maybe close your eyes if it feels comfortable. Hopefully you're sufficiently caffeinated you won't fall back asleep. And I invite you to feel what is beneath you. What's holding you up? Whether it is firm or soft, whether it is solid or squishy, these are your roots. The roots of your people, the roots of your ancestors, roots that include grief and loss and struggle, but also resilience and resistance. And from there, from what you are rooted in, feel what is rising up in and through your body, maybe your tall spine, flowing or sparse hair, Notice what is reaching. Rooted and reaching, we are here. And I'm going to invite you into a reflection further on that with the words of Lisa Littlebird, a contemporary singer who uses music as medicine for healing, for strengthening. She captured these words, put your roots down, put your feet on the ground. You can hear the earth sing if you listen. The same sound of the river as it moves across the stones is the same sound of the blood in your body as it moves across your bones. Are you listening? Are you listening? Put your roots down. Put your feet on the ground. You can hear the earth sing if you listen. The sound of the water as it moves across the stones is the same sound of the blood in your body as it moves across your bones. Are you listening? So may our time together today be one of continued rooting and continued reaching for resistance and resilience, for our connection to the ancestors and elders, to our descendants. Root down, my friends. Reach. Here's to the work.
This is Kim speaking, and I want to thank Reverend Matthew for welcoming us, getting us focused, grounded, and intentional on and centered on the impact of discrimination on health. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Honorable Tommy Stallworth. Thomas Stallworth currently serves as Senior Advisor for Legislative and External Affairs for Michigan's Governor Gretchen Whitmer and is president of the Stallworth Consulting Group, LLC, a strategic government relations and systems change management firm. His role includes acting as former director of Michigan's Coronavirus Racial Disparities Task Force, where he led the effort in support of Lieutenant Governor Gilchrist to respond to the pandemic and address racial equity gaps in health, education, and economic opportunities. With his vast experience in government work and also as a key leader in the COVID-19 Task Force on Racial Disparities, we believe that Honorable Stallworth is the right person to lead us into our breakout conversation and to officially begin this work. And we now welcome him to the stage.
Thank you, Kim. I am so glad you didn't read that bio I sent you. It was way too long. Good morning. It is a beautiful day, and I am just so honored to have an opportunity to be here with you. As a lifelong advocate for social justice and racial equity, it's rare I get to be in a room with so many like-minded folks. This is a real treat, and I'm looking forward to today. Let me first thank John Johnson and the Michigan Department of Civil Rights for hosting this event. Let's give his team a round of applause. They are doing such a great job and such a tremendous service. I also want to thank you all for being here this morning and for being such tireless program and project leaders around social justice, for your advocacy to achieve equitable discrimination-free Michigan. We're making a lot of progress, which I'd like to talk a little bit about, but quite frankly, we could achieve none of it without your hard work and your contributions and support. Just in a way of self-introduction, I don't consider myself a great public speaker, so I'm honored to be asked to be here, but I'm gonna ask for your patience. I mean, it's been 3 years since I was even in public, right? So I'm gonna ask for your patience. I may be a little awkward as I go through my remarks, but I'll do my best to set the tone for today, and I'm gonna talk to you like we're family, because we are. We're family in the struggle. What I'd like to do, and consistent with the theme, is examine and talk a little bit about the impact of discrimination on health and its impact on communities of color. And we'll use the pandemic as an example of how disparate treatment, disparate systems result in higher death rates and disproportionality, ultimately as relates to the pandemic, giving us some really tragic results. But before I do that, let's talk a little bit and reflect a little bit about where we are here in Michigan. We're in some unique times. We've accomplished a lot. It has been over 40 years since we've been in a governance structure with a governor and legislature that demonstrates such a high commitment to equity and social justice. I'm not sure if so much has happened over the last few weeks and months. I'd like to just spend a little time so we can celebrate some of the accomplishments and progress we've had in Michigan. And quite frankly, Michigan is leading the nation in some of these things. We've got a tremendous governor. I neglected my responsibility in not offering welcomes to you and thanks to you on behalf of the governor and lieutenant governor. Because, you know, they are tremendously committed and to working with you as partners in the struggle for equity. Let's talk a little bit. I want to just share with you what the administration has accomplished. As relates to building an inclusive government in Michigan, you may or may not know this, but our governor has appointed more than 535 Black Michiganders to boards, commissions, and full-time positions. I said 535. I don't see you guys smiling. That's a big number, okay? That's a big number. Over 60% of her appointees are women or people of color. 23 or 31% of judicial appointees are Black, including the first Black woman on the Michigan Supreme Court. She worked with the Civil Service Commission to make Juneteenth a state holiday. And she signed the Bipartisan Crown Act, most recently, banning discrimination based on hair in Michigan. You know, we work so hard, I think it's important to celebrate some of these things because, you know, they actually have a tremendous impact on people's lives. And this is what change is all about, right? And this is how we address discrimination. And it's not only its impact on health, but impact on education, on wealth, on housing, et cetera. As we think about Michigan's economy, she secured 32,000 good-paying auto jobs in the first auto plant in Detroit in nearly 30 years. And probably a little-known fact, you know, through her leadership, we actually hired a black woman-owned firm to oversee $3.5 billion as part of our Rebuilding Michigan plan. And so that firm actually is overseeing the financing for a lot of the construction, the road construction that we tried to navigate on the way here. And who would have thought? Who would have thought? I certainly didn't think in my lifetime in here in the state of Michigan that the state would ever give the responsibility of over $3 billion to a black woman-owned firm. Did you? Most recently, we signed an executive directive raising the diversity goal for state contracting dollars. You may or may not be aware of that, but now every state department is required to monitor and report on their diversity goals as relates to contract work. And over $370 million in construction contracts have been awarded to firms owned and operated by people of color and women under MDOT's Disadvantaged Business Enterprise Plan. Additionally, we've expanded access to affordable childcare for 150,000 more children. Yeah, that's pretty cool, right? Now a family of four earning up to $55,000 is eligible for free or low-cost childcare. And as I got a one-year-old grandson, my daughter's always complaining about how expensive childcare is. So you all know this is like a tremendous, tremendous gift and blessing for our community. We've put Michigan students first with $9,150 per student funding, the highest ever state funding, raised per pupil funding by $1,279, and closed the funding gap for education, ensuring every school district has the same baseline funding and consistently dedicated more state resources to students with the highest needs. We've put a lot of emphasis on focusing on high-risk students and making sure that adequate resources are provided to drive the improved academic outcomes that we also desperately desire. On the criminal justice side, we signed the Clean Slate bills, making hundreds of thousands of Michiganders eligible to have their records expunged. I know with this group, I don't have to talk to you about, you know, the disproportionality, right, of what's gone on in our criminal justice system and what the profile of our prisons look like. Over 50% of those in prison are people of color. Approximately 50% are functionally illiterate. I mean, if we want to connect our dots, right? We understand how our education system fails people, ultimately leading to poverty and crime and incarceration. Incarceration sentences that actually have, up to this point, lasted their lifetime. With these expungement bills, folks now have an opportunity to have a clean slate and a fresh start once they re-enter society. Critically important. But in addition to that, the governor has called on the legislature to ban chokeholds, limit no-knock warrants, require independent investigations of police shootings, and mandate retention of disciplinary records resulting from improper use of force. You'll see a lot more about that this fall as the legislature begins to move on those policy recommendations. And as it relates to health, we'll talk a little bit about the work that's been done with the Racial Disparities Task Force, but we've also made significant investments to address sickle cell treatment. And many of you may not know that, we have thousands of citizens who, once they become adults, were not eligible for Medicaid health coverage based on their condition. We've changed that, and we funded it such that those folks can now receive treatment. Additionally, and I'll end here, but she declared racism a public health crisis and required all medical professionals to undergo implicit bias training to improve health care and target disparities. And so at this point, every health professional is required to participate in implicit bias training as part of the licensing process, and again, in an attempt to try to directly address discriminatory practices by raising awareness of those who are delivering services. And so again, I just went through a pretty significant list. In my lifetime, I never thought that level of emphasis and change would be driven around race and equity. And these are things, given your work and your participation here, I know you are equally committed to and probably equally happy about. But let's talk a little bit about our Racial Disparities Task Force. Kim, how much time do I have? Don't let me go too long. I'm good? Okay. Let me first thank those who participated on our Racial Disparities Task Force. Do I have any folks here who participated on our calls? If I do, please raise your hands or stand up so I can see you. I know I got one. There's some more over there. Thank you. I had to thank these folks because, you know, as we think about the pandemic and the tragic, horrific impact it had on communities of color and on Michigan in general, these folks met on a weekly basis on Fridays from 3 to 5 to track what was happening in our communities and what improvements were occurring or what surges were occurring, and then helping to design interventions to address and reduce the rates of death. They did very important work. Please give them a round of applause, please. Thank you. So Governor Whitmer, you know, I don't know, I guess you all remember 3 years ago back in March when we discovered there was a pandemic and the coronavirus hit Michigan. What we realized at that time were there were thousands of people dying and that there were disproportionate deaths occurring in communities of color. The governor established a task force to study the causes of the coronavirus related to racial disparities and recommended action and to recommend actions to address the historic and systemic inequities that were the cause of those disproportionate impacts. Initially, African Americans, representing nearly only 14% of the state's population represented 40% of the deaths in Michigan. At the end of the pandemic, we've experienced close to 10,000 deaths in the Black community alone. We don't even begin, can't even begin to even understand what that impact will be on families, on their legacy, on their infrastructure in terms of supporting their children and the children to come. We were charged with increasing transparency in reporting data, removing barriers to accessing physical and mental health care, reducing the impact of medical bias in testing and treatment. You, believe it or not, may not recall that early in the pandemic, we had many reports of Black citizens going to urgent care and being refused the opportunity to be tested, actually just being sent home. Ultimately, many of them became critically ill. We were also charged with developing and improving systems for supporting long-term economic recovery, physical and mental health. So I just real quickly want to just share with you and remind you of just how horrific the impacts were. At the onset of the pandemic, Black death rates were approximately 20 times greater than those in the white community. Native Americans were also disproportionately impacted in early surges, with death rates 4 to 5 times greater than their white citizens, than our white citizens. This is not to, I mean, the pandemic, there, you know, was horrific and impacted all communities, but there was severe, severe disproportionality that we can only assume was the result of unequal systems and unequal care. The folks we just recognized are folks who were charged with intervening and driving results to improve that. By the end of the pandemic, we actually had closed the gap and eliminated the racial disparities associated with death. Did y'all hear me? I said we eliminated the disparities associated with death. In doing so, there were a number of things that we accomplished. We received the Meeting the Moment Public Health Award from Research America. We reduced average new Black cases from 176 per million per day at the on-site to 59. We reduced probable Black deaths per million per day from 21.7 to 1. And we had many contributors and collaborative partners. Ford Motor Company worked with us on the design and funding of 10 mobile health units, which we deployed throughout Michigan to take care directly to citizens in marginalized communities. We established neighborhood testing sites, 22 of them, in fact, around the state, and where that made it walkable for in socially vulnerable communities. We distributed $17.6 million to 33 local community organizations such that they could define the services and responses that were needed in their communities, and that's how we drove the closure of those disparate death rates, through collaborative efforts with our communities. But most importantly, I shouldn't say most importantly, but I think it's important to recognize that despite those accomplishments, there's still much work to be done, right? Because we know, and you're going to talk about it, and you should go into your breakout rooms, that that disparate treatment still exists across our systems of care, all of them. And so the task force, in recognition of that, also proposed over $300 million of funding to change the infrastructure around healthcare and to drive initiatives that would continue the work of closing racial disparities. A couple of things I just want to mention. $300 million were proposed for school air quality. Again, African-American communities, black children in poor communities are disproportionately affected by asthma. And what we learned during the pandemic is that the kids would go to school, poor air quality, virus spreads, they bring it home, parents get sick, grandparents get sick, et cetera. So this initiative in terms of infrastructure is critical to addressing and preventing the next pandemic from having the same effect. We've proposed $18 million for 22 neighborhood health centers with the anticipation that they'll be walkable in poor communities, that citizens can go there and get tested not only for the coronavirus, but they can get tested for blood pressure, they can be directed to Medicaid services or enrolled in Medicaid services, et cetera. And then, of course, we've got another $6 million for mobile health units to continue their work across the state. Those are just examples. I'm gonna ask, but there'll be an announcement probably this week about what actually gets funded in this year's budget. I want you to be on the lookout for it because it's probably not going to be enough. So there's more work to be done. And you are needed, right? Your continued advocacy at the legislative level, your continued participation in problem solving and improving services to the community, you are the key to driving the results that we want. We need your help. There is a call to action, which is why you're here. So I'm going to ask that you fully engage in the breakout sessions as we talk about discriminatory practices, as we explore what policy changes can be made, as we identify best practices, many of which you guys have developed and lead. We want to learn from each other. But most importantly, what we want to do is come out of this session, this conference, to drive with some intentionality and commitment to driving results that improve the delivery of an equitable, discrimination-free, just society for every Michigan citizen. That is our goal today. If we can come out of these meetings with a list of actionable items and initiatives that will help drive those results, I think we will have had a successful day. Again, I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules, for being here. My name's Tommy Stallworth. I am a senior advisor to the governor, and I am at your service. If there's anything I can do to help you, to support you, please don't hesitate to let me know. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. My name is John Johnson. I have the pleasure of serving as the Executive Director of the Michigan Department of Civil Rights. I welcome you here this morning. Give yourself a hand for showing up. I know it was an obstacle for some battling the traffic getting here, but we're glad you made it, and we look forward to sharing some information with you today that I think will make it worth your while to be here. Want to thank Tommy Stallworth for his remarks and the assistance he gives us through his work through the state. He comes from a long line of public servants. We heard about him is kind of understated. He served as a state rep for several years. His mother served as a state rep. She was an expert in telecommunications and energy. His brother served as a state rep. His daughter served on the Detroit Board of Education. So he comes from a long line of public service. We appreciate him. We appreciate what he does, for the state of Michigan, and certainly what he's done for this agency. Him and Governor Whitmer has recognized the importance of civil rights, and they've demonstrated that through their actions in terms of recommending an increase in our budget of almost $9 million, which will help us. Yes, please give them a hand. Which will help us serve you better in terms of our statewide obligation to attack and remedy discrimination in Michigan. So we appreciate your work, Tommy. We appreciate the long list of accomplishments you detailed from Governor Whitmer. It's obvious that she has your interest in mind. We are like-minded, as Tommy said, so we're glad that you're here to enjoy this experience with us. I would be remiss if I didn't thank the staff of MDCR for putting this together. A tremendous effort. This is our second time. I want everybody on MDCR staff to please stand and be recognized right now. Please, let's give them a hand. A very special shout out to our Director of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, Alfredo Hernandez-Corzin, for putting together this program as he did last year. Thank you, Alfredo. And for our Special Projects Director, Harold Kaur, who arranged all the logistics along with a number of other members of our staff, and I'm sure they'll be introduced later and thanked appropriately by Alfredo as we go through this program. But as I mentioned before, we are convening for the second time. We came together about a year ago in Lansing to discuss the isms and how they impact discrimination in the state of Michigan. It's important we come together as activists, as social justice activists, in order to share information, communicate, network, and develop strategies for the fight that continues every day in the work that we do. So again, our job, again, as MDCR, is to attack discrimination at every level, educate people about that so they don't commit discrimination, and also to foster diversity, equity, and inclusion. This has obvious benefits and helps to drive all of our work forward. As I mentioned, last year's summit focused on the intersectionality and the impact of the isms, racism, sexism, classism, ableism on our state, as well as strategies for dismantling discrimination at a personal, interpersonal, structural, and institutional level. We had breakout sessions during which we discussed these isms as they related to equity in education, health, housing, economics. We also discussed voting rights and democracy. It's important that we talk about what we did last year because people say, well, you had these conferences, what do you do? And Tommy mentioned that it's important we come out with strategies, but it's more important that we implement some of those strategies. So we want to take a few minutes to review what we did last year in anticipation of what we're going to do this year. So today, as we break for our workshops, I want to take a few minutes to update you on what came out of last year's summit. We had a section exploring education equity, and the panelists concluded that we needed a multi-pronged approach, including using data-driven decisions based on educational equity action plans at the institutional level. Now, MDCR had already, based upon the actions of our commission, developed an equity resource template in cooperation with our Council for Government and Education on Equity and Inclusion. Our resource guide to developing a school equity plan was inspired by the work of the Michigan Civil Rights Commission during their 2021 Educational Equity Report. Our ongoing efforts include working with educational institutions in Michigan to promote this school equity plan. We understand that equity does not happen without intentional strategies and planning, and the resource guide can help us to provide measurable target roadmaps to progress in all of our schools across the state of Michigan. We've engaged the Michigan Department of Education helping us to promote this equity resource guide. We hope to implement that again in districts throughout the state. In our health equity session, and by the way, this is a result of that, because as you know, our theme this year is on health and discrimination. Our panelists concluded that moving the needle on health equity and improving health outcomes for marginalized communities required, one, a targeted effort to share research about health equity, and two, training healthcare workers in cultural competencies. Well, as for the latter, we discovered that in 2020, Governor Whitmer mandated internal bias training for healthcare providers and the collection and analysis of data differences in health outcomes among racial and ethnic groups in Michigan. And Tommy already talked to you about the Racial Disparity Task Force and their outcomes and their strategies. Additionally, 3 years ago, the Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs established rules for implicit bias training standards as part of the knowledge and skills necessary for licensing and registering health professionals in Michigan. So that implicit bias training and cultural competency training is ongoing within our state, thanks to our governor. During our housing equity session, panelists discussed the serious lack of effort to address home ownership rates, evictions, and segregation in Michigan. The main strategies discussed involved the promotion and distribution of housing resources to people of color that were directly impacted by discriminatory federal policies. As one approach, we are pleased to report that the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services is working with the Office of Global Michigan to launch the, quote, newcomer rental subsidy program, end quote. This program aims to provide rental assistance to newly arrived refugees and other immigrant families for up to 1 year while they're getting established here in Michigan. OGM will distribute the funds to their refugee settlement agencies to provide between $300 and $500 per month in rental assistance to eligible families. The rental assistance is intended to increase access to housing options so that families can live closer to work or afford larger units. The funding may also broaden the number of neighborhoods that are affordable for families. The housing session also highlighted the need to promote the increase of bank investments in lower and moderate income communities through the Community Reinvestment Act of 1977. This act requires banks to invest in communities that have been underserved by the financial industry. During the past year, Steve Tomkowiak and the Fair Housing Center at Metropolitan Detroit, as a member of the Detroit Community Reinvestment Act Coalition, has worked with lenders like Huntington, Flagstar, and others to negotiate community benefit agreements. Also, the Michigan Department of Civil Rights intends to explore the issues of discrimination in the housing industry, including renting and ownership, including appraisal bias and credit bias, loan denials, and property insurance. Look forward to another session of this type within the next several months in which we will explore discrimination in the housing industry. In our voting rights and democracy session, panelists discussed the importance of educating voters in ways that directly connect the practice of voting with its impact on everyday issues. One strategy involved using compelling storytelling in voter education campaigns to connect voting rights with social justice issues. Voting is a civil right. Voting is a civil right. And we intend to educate the citizens about those rights via our Voting Rights Project, which we will use social media and personal interaction to reach out to voters and potential voters, especially those who are disabled or have limited English proficiency. We must get out in the community and advise everyone of their right to vote. Laws have been changed. More laws have been introduced in legislature. It will fundamentally affect the way we vote in Michigan. People need to know their rights and need to exercise them at every level. In our economic equity session, panelists discussed strategies to ensure all Michiganders can truly see themselves as part of the state's economy. Solutions would involve addressing decades of disinvestment and promoting more equitable access to economic programs. In July of this year, the Michigan Strategic Fund will be releasing applications for the Small Business Smart Zone program. The effort is designed to serve businesses that were disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. This is a great example of the kind of program that can provide valuable boost to underserved communities. For more information, contact Eileen Boven at MEDC. That's the Michigan Economic Development Corporation, by the way. And as part of discussion on operationalizing equity across the state and increasing cultural competency through programs such as the United Way 21-Day Challenge, popular through social media, this challenge provides daily prompts to reflect on the impact of systemic discrimination at a personal, interpersonal, institutional, and structural level. State agencies also conduct other internal initiatives to increase racial consciousness and cultural competency among the workforce. We thank again our DEI Director Alfredo Hernandez-Corza for being involved in that implicit bias throughout the state and throughout state agencies. Now, this is just a short summary of some of the work being done around the state. And after this summit, we intend to continue moving the needle. And we thank each of you for your collaboration. I want you to take a look at this agenda. It addresses almost every issue you can imagine in regards to health equity. I want to thank the planning committee that helped Alfredo put this together. And I also want to thank our sponsors, which we listed on the back of this. Again, the impact of discrimination on health. We witness that in every area of life. And again, one of the main areas in which we'll be focusing on today and next and in a few months will be housing, because that affects health and wealth. And that's what we should be about here in terms of civil rights, making sure that those rights are enforced and that you get to enjoy the opportunities that are available to everyone in this state. We're about to take a 15-minute break before we move into the workshops. Please don't forget to download the WOVA app or the QR codes to download digital versions of this program. We hope that you enjoy this day. We look forward to the information you will receive and share. And at the end of this, again, discuss strategies and implementation of strategies going forward. Thank you so much for your attention.
Good morning. My name is Valerie Barkley. I am one of the proud members of the MDCR team. So thank you so much, Director Johnson, for a very thoughtful recap of the 2022 Civil Rights Summit last year. But before I get into my quick little spiel and we take our break, I just have to say this is so fantastic to have so many civil rights champions out there. Thank you. Thank you so much for the work that you do and are continuing to do to make Michigan a better place for everyone that we love. So with that said, we recognize that coming together to discuss very important topics centered on creating and sustaining more equitable access and opportunities is extremely important. Yet we also recognize the need to move from words into action, and we appreciate the recap Director Johnson has provided us as we continue the conversation and the exploration of these important issues this year and for many years to come. With that said, I'm here to go over just a couple key points for the rest of the day. We're going to take a short break, and then we will resume at 10:15 with our morning breakout sessions. Education and health is in breakout room 1. Environmental justice and health is in breakout room 2. I believe those are out and to your right. So please stay in this room if you are going to social determinants of health. Thank you so much again, everyone, and you may now take your break, and we'll see you at 10:15.